So thank you to the organizers, and thank you, Melinda, for the introduction. So, you know, I'd like to start by briefly asking all of our panelists to introduce themselves and provide a few short remarks, about 3 minutes or so, about themselves and some of their perspectives as it relates to where they see the field moving and going, since this panel is focused on science advancements and the future of GEMS. So we're going to start by going in the order listed on the agenda. And so with that, I will ask Megan Palmer.
Fantastic. It's great to be with you here today. So I'm Megan Palmer. I'm currently the Executive Director of Biopolicy and Leadership Initiatives at Stanford University, which is between our Department of Bioengineering and one of our interdisciplinary policy institutes. And I'm also an adjunct professor in bioengineering. My own background is in bioengineering, but I've spent the last 12 years or so really focused on policy issues coupled to advances in biotechnology and synthetic biology in particular. And the first 5 of those years was actually directing an integrated policy research institute, integrated policy component of a multi-university center in synthetic biology that was supported by the National Science Foundation, of which David on this panel was also a participant, among many others that we've also welcomed here today. And many of those topics that we covered were around work on safety and security and governance issues, both from the policy side and the social science side, but also in how do we inform and inspire technology innovations and regulatory science innovations that could meet the needs in that space. So one of the most important activities coupled to this center that I was asked to highlight, I'm actually not from iGEM on that first slide, but I've spent the last 15 or so years working with the International Genetically Engineered Machine Competition as a volunteer. We actually do work with the competition as part of my group at Stanford. So iGEM, for those of you who may not be familiar, is the sort of leading training grounds in synthetic biology. Every year, teams of primarily but not exclusively students will come together and develop a project to develop a genetically encoded part, and then use that to build a biological system that does something useful. It's an open design challenge. And so now the iGEM competition has run for 17 years, involves thousands of students on hundreds of teams from dozens of countries. And one of the innovations in that competition was giving prizes not just for cool technology, but rather for innovative and excellent approaches to interfacing with issues around policy and governance and responsible innovation. And what this has led to is really a global testbed and observatory to both see what is on the horizon when it comes to a wide array of potential applications, and also an incentive and community to really innovate around the increasing ambiguity and uncertainty that is coupled to the governance sphere and regulatory sphere. And so when I look on the future of the GMs, I think the biggest lesson here is that we need to build more of these open, collaborative test beds that interface communities working in policy and regulatory issues with those working in technology right from the very beginning of their education and training, so that as they develop new labs and companies, they have a fundamentally different posture towards many of these issues and know where to start. So thanks. I'm looking forward to the discussion today.
Great, thank you. And at this time, I'll invite David to introduce himself.
Thanks, everyone. Happy to be here. My name is Dave Savage, and I'm an associate professor in the Department of Molecular and Cell Biology at UC Berkeley and the IGI. So my lab is interested in the biochemistry of carbon dioxide fixation, and we actually have a particular interest in exploring the diversity of mechanisms used by microbes in order to engineer improved carbon fixation pathways. We also develop genome editing tools and have a long-term interest in developing enabling technologies in this space, not to do microbial work, but to simplify plant genetics and allow us to move some of these principles and pathways that we find in microbes into plants. So just as one example, We spent a number of years in trying to understand how something called the CO2 concentrating mechanism, which is a pathway found in cyanobacteria and is responsible for actually 10 to 20% of global carbon fixation, of how that is so efficient in the microbes that it's resident in. So what we've done is combine hydrogenetics, biochemistry, and modeling to develop a working model of CCM function, experimentally map these functions then to putative genes, which were identified in various screens. And finally, using the synthetic biology approaches you're probably aware of, we've been able to show that we can take these various elements of the pathways, the protein machinery, and move it from the natural host into the lab model of E. coli and actually enable and engineer E. coli to grow more robustly by fixing CO2 directly out of the air. So sort of it really in the sense of synthetic biology is building new things and proving that they're working by building them. So as a sort of a technologist, you know, I'm really excited to continue our work on microbial systems and explore avenues for improving and engineering the physiology of one carbon metabolism. This would be both in industrially relevant organisms as well as plants. And from this technical perspective, though, I think, you know, we'll see continued refinement of the various synthetic biology techniques, even some we just saw from the previous speaker, MAGE and things like that, in terms of where advances in DNA synthesis and writing continue to advance at an exponential pace, and researchers put those things to use. At the same time, I'm particularly interested in agriculture in particular because of its scale, because we know that there are potential applications not just for food, but in carbon dioxide removal. And so from this microbial perspective, I think there's a lot to think about in terms of how combinations of engineered organisms, be it at the plant level or at the microbial level, are interacting in the context of soil. And both at, you know, at the basic science level, all the questions of that will be answered therein, and from the regulatory perspective, how we'll actually think about that and regulate it properly. So thanks.
Great, thank you. And Rodolphe?
Hi, everyone. My name is Rodolphe Barrangou. I'm a professor, distinguished professor here at NC State University in the Department of Food, Bioprocessing, and Nutrition Sciences. So I have a little bit of an academic perspective, but I'm also an advisor to the IGI. I'm also the editor-in-chief of the CRISPR Journal. So I also have a stakeholder vantage point through which I see things. And then, of course, as somebody who spent 10 years in the industry working on CRISPR in industrially relevant bacteria, and also an entrepreneur who's working with a number of companies in that space, there's also an entrepreneurial prism through which I see things. And I think that's important given the poll that we had earlier today about the diversity, the mosaicism of people we have on the call here. So a couple of things of interest to me, and I think I want to start with framing something about the perception of regulations, because we hear a lot about regulations today and we'll hear about a lot more tomorrow, but I want to remind everyone here who's not a regulator, which is most of us, that regulatory approval is not a limiting factor, but an enabling factor. And that it's not a barrier whatsoever, but rather a driver of monetization of innovative products that we're working on, right? And we can see, and we've seen repeatedly through all the talks that we've heard from the EPA, the USDA, and the FDA, that the people informing us today are part of the same team. It's not us against them. It's not us and them, it's we're all part of the same team. So we're all here together to work through that. I feel like it's very important to remind the audience of this. Now let's get on to the CRISPR toolbox and the CRISPR craze, which is very hard to keep up with. And some information, some data, some numbers to give some perspective to everyone here, right? 29,000 papers have been published on this topic in the last 10 years. They've been published by 47,000 authors representing 4,500 different affiliations in over 100 countries. So it's great that we have 800 registrants, but we also only have 800 registrants, right? How are we going to see that? How are we going to advance that? And the reason it's important is because all those papers, 29,000 papers, illustrate the diversity of the toolbox that we're working on, and it's going fast and it's moving fast, and the science is moving faster than the regulations. And we talk about Cas9, but we talk about Cas12, and we talk about Cas3, we talk about Cas13, and we talk about Cas transposons and transposases. We just heard about SynBio, right? Recombinases and integrases and retrons and whatnot. And it's important to think as users and developers of those technologies, what the implications will be for regulation, with the understanding that it's not the how we're doing it, but the what we're doing, it's not the process, it's the product. So that's very important, but we also have to keep educating everyone, including the regulators, what those technologies are and how we're deploying them. And as we develop them, as we just heard from David, we have to keep in mind the applications and the implications. And then last but not least, even though we would like to wear one hat, right? Entrepreneur or academic, scientist or regulator, we have to think about the context of the conversation, which will be discussed tomorrow heavily, but I want to bring it up here as well. Because as an innovator, I have to understand and realize the context in which we operate. We have to be transparent. We all have responsibility for stewardship with the public. Science communication is all of our jobs here. And I'm going to echo what Megan just said a few minutes ago. I think she mentioned like collaborative testbed. We are doing the experiment, not just in the lab, but collectively in workshops like this. And I hope that we get to discuss that as well. But we all have to cover all those aspects at the same time.
Great, thank you. And Anne, can you introduce yourself?
Yes, afternoon, everybody. Thank you for the invitation. I'm Anne Cheever. I'm a program manager from DARPA's Biological Technologies Office. For those who are not familiar, DARPA is part of the DoD. It stands for Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. We have the mission to make investments in breakthrough technologies for national security. My portfolio there is mainly synthetic biology based. My current work includes genome editing and biomanufacturing programs. So today I wanted to tell you a little bit about Safe Genes, which is a program to address the need for innovation in biosafety and biosecurity in the context of emergent genome editing tools and their derivative technologies like gene drives. So this program is developing biological tools to control, counter, and reverse genome editors. And the goal is to really create a diverse biological toolkit that can enable the safe pursuit of advanced gene editing applications, but also those same tools can protect against potential engineered genetic threats. So the point being that prior to this program, there were no solutions or countermeasures to genome editors, so that risk of unintentional consequences or misuse had no mitigation measures. So combined with the fact that advances in these areas are so fast, really kind of outpacing the methods to control these technologies. When this program started, we were really faced with that lack of controls, a lack of countermeasures, as well as off-target effects, and really a lack of precision from genome editors. So that, that biosecurity dilemma that you can think of as resulting from that pointed toward that need for safety by design. So building in at the inception of new tools, those safety measures. So the three technical areas of the program, you can think of them as control, counter, and reverse. You know, controlling gene editors, turning them on and off with a specific molecule. Countermeasures inhibit gene editing activity, mainly nucleic acid, small molecule, or protein inhibitors. And then reversing, so focusing on tools that can remove gene edits and restore the original DNA sequence. And so the program has been going for 4 years. There have been quite a few technologies and advancements that have been published that have come out of the program. You know, from the beginning, part of the strategy was to include regulators. Regulatory professionals are the experts in bringing these things to deployment, to market, to commercial use. So we have always included them in our program reviews. We've invited them to, you know, review proposals. You know, I think as a funder, it's, you know, we can be that bridge between the technology developers and the regulators to kind of make sure that there's some information flow about what's being developed. And so, you know, ends up being good for everyone. For us, of course, transition. We want these technologies to transition. You know, some of our performers want to spin out companies. So making sure that the regulators are involved and understand and can see what's coming down the road potentially has been really beneficial. So I'll stop there. I can give some examples later on, perhaps of some of the successes there or some recommendations. Thanks.
Great, thank you all. So in each of your opening remarks, you all touched on a number of different things that I wanted to follow up on in the course of this conversation. But I think I'll start by asking sort of a general question to the group of when you think about what's coming and the advances and developments that are happening, you know, iGEM is a great place to see all of the different potential types of products that may be coming down the line. what types of products or technology developments do you anticipate coming to the regulatory agencies that may be new for them in the next 5 to 10 years that may pose potential challenges? And if you pose a challenge or identify a potential barrier, please try to think about, you know, how can we work around these or find solutions and work together? As Rodolphe said, right, we're all on the same team here to figure out how we can move toward a streamlined process. So I'll open it up maybe to Megan as a starting from the iGEM perspective, but anyone else is welcome to jump in as well.
Sure. It's hard to point to just one thing that I see on the horizon. And I think what I see in general is that you know, through the competition, you see these early indicators of the sort of scale of just the number of different ideas, as well as the new types of interfaces in which they are proposing products. And so it's those strange interfaces or the categories that don't quite fit that are becoming more and more common. And so there's a big question on whether or not we actually accommodate these within our current structures, or we use them as an opportunity to revisit whether or not our assumptions embedded in our regulatory frameworks are still holding up. I did some work on this, including through cases at iGEM and through some of the DARPA programs, actually looking at the way we handle regulatory anomalies, along with Sam Weiss-Evans at Harvard on this work. And I think that's one of the overarching challenges. I think what's interesting to see with some of these students, as well as many of the folks who are starting companies, is the extent to which they see the current frameworks as being sort of immovable. And so they're engineering around them and around the current categories, or whether or not they see prospects of revisions on the horizon. And so I think that's going to be a major challenge. And it was actually, I think, covered quite well in the National Academies report that was referenced earlier in terms of products that are on the horizon, but it's just the sheer scale number of these projects across many different geographies and contexts that is going to be a big challenge for us to handle.
Yeah, if I can follow up on this, I would say in some ways, regulations are a phylogeny, right? It's evolving. And if you try to fit something into a box, it's going to change over time. So I think as we deepen the sophistication of the tools that we use, and everybody realizes that what we're doing and what we're using is not going to fall within the existing category, with an existing policy that was devised years before the technology was developed or implemented, again, we have to work together preemptively to make that work and find a way to regulate this in a very realistic and practical way. So let me give a very tangible example based on what Spencer discussed about two sessions ago. If we use CRISPR to engineer phages that are going to deliver genome editing payload that will be deployed at scale for community editing in an ag soil environment, how are we going to regulate that? I mean, literally, like that, like Russian doll type, you know, level of sophistication of engineering is presumably not going to fall into something that exists today. And it may not even be easy to see, well, we're going to take this piece, and then that's what the combination is going to be and fall under. So as we get more and more sophisticated, more and more creative, and do combinations of synthetic biology and CRISPR and genome editing and delivery modalities, and do that at scale in new environments, doing things that we thought were science fiction just a couple of years ago, we all understand and realize that we're going to have to work as we develop those on the regulatory implications and applications. And that's where it starts, not where it ends.
Great. Thank you for those comments. I don't know, David or Anne, do you want to take a stab at the question?
Yeah, I mean, I think from a technical point of view, I mean, if we're talking sort of, you know, pretty technically, I think that some of the epigenetic modifications, at least for therapeutics, are going to come online, as well as potentially post-modulation, as opposed to targeting pathogens or targeting the actual other organisms, microbes. So that's one thing that pops up quite a bit.
Great, thank you. So, I'm sorry, David, go ahead. Okay, so I think Rodolphe, you brought me right to my next question, which there was a question in the chat earlier this morning. I don't know if you caught it or others caught it, but talking about the nuances in language and terminology and how as that continues to advance and our technology advances, it quickly outpaces what gets established and set in statute and in policy. And so it is a long process. It is difficult to go back and continuously renew and update these processes. And that must have an impact on innovation. Or as Megan says, folks start to get creative about other ways to get around some of these barriers. And I'm wondering, how do we think about constructive solutions for keeping everything moving up to date or moving together so that we are not always in the case of where the regulatory rules and policies are sort of lagging behind technology development? What are some strategies we can use as a global community in this space?
Yeah, so I think, I mean, that gap is always going to exist to some extent, right? Because as we develop cutting edge technologies on the highway of science and we build the road behind us and eventually put the safety barriers and the guardrails, we're going to have a gap for sure. But as we heard repeatedly today, we have to highlight the existing integrated frameworks that work or that are relevant or that make sense and build off of them. And then also seize the opportunities to do what's called consultations. We just heard about examples, right? And this has been mentioned multiple times. Reach out to those people proactively. Don't wait until you want to submit your dossier to reach out to them and be like, what do you think now, right? You have to reach out earlier than you think. Think of like a bioarchive of regulatory, right? Like reach out to them, put it out there, talk to them, get some feedback, get some input. And because sometimes it's going to take time for people to have formal comments or informal comments and opine on this, well, this makes sense. So think about this, or this implication, or this application, or maybe this other framework that exists in some other regulatory agency or other regulatory jurisdiction elsewhere in the world, that should be considered or thought about. That's how I think we're going to close that gap, but we have to be proactive and it's never too early, but it can be too late.
I'll just complement this by saying, in addition to sort of innovators reaching out, I think there's a lot of things we can do in the ecosystem in order to support those interfaces, again, between those who are funding the work, those who have to oversee the work, those who are pursuing the work. Through the National Science Foundation Center that we mentioned before, having actually, we had a quarter at the end of this major grant that was dedicated to different types of basic and applied research on how we improve in our regulatory science, among other topics, that engaged a number of different types of stakeholders, including folks at regulatory agencies, but also senior investigators and their students that then went on and made some of these topics an inspiration for some of their work, including working with people like Anne and her programs and thinking about the types of technology innovations and measurement tools and everything else we need to support. I will also say I'm a big fan of fellowships that help to develop those relationships with the different folks who have a stake in overseeing and safeguarding our technologies, and doing that really early is part of the sort of basic needs finding and assessment, both at the project level and at the entire portfolio of your lab or your company, very early on. So just second that as well.
Yeah, and I'll just mention that, so Rodolphe, I think you mentioned that the whole lifetime of a program or an effort. So starting at the very beginning, you know, there are ways or tasks that can be funded. So as part of a technology development program, funding tasks to create a regulatory strategy along with that. So starting at the very beginning, all the way to the end, where, you know, from my perspective, having regulators in those program reviews or in that transition meeting with follow-on funders or commercial or venture capitalists even. So just having them involved and sort of making sure that they're engaging early and often is probably the main thing.
And that is interesting from the DARPA perspective in terms of like thinking about, could you build that in as milestones, right? Into a grant is actually literally just engagement as part of the milestone. You know, it seems like it makes a lot of sense, and it's not something that we normally see from the traditional other funding agencies, unless, you know, it's part of a more translational type grant. But you could do this in an R01 at NIH, right, if you had an interest in that.
One of the things I also wanted to mention as an opportunity that we've seen is when we got some of the regulators and others in a room, including at the iGEM competition. So that's one place where you actually, instead of reaching out to the regulars, invite them to the competition to take part and test out some of the approaches that they might be thinking about. And that it's also about developing those relationships across groups that are thinking about how to be, you know, proactive and responsible in our approaches and keep pace. And so I think that meetings like this and others that can foster more of that cross-agency communication, not only in the US, but also in partnership with other countries, is going to be really important so we can test and validate our approaches over time.
Yeah, since someone mentioned VCs and investors, right? I wanna remind the innovators out there that are fundraising or thinking about a startup or new patent or new company or new license, that accounting for the regulatory path to the commercialization and monetization of your technology and or your product really showcases to a group of investors why you're de-risking their investment. So it's not an obligatory thing you have to account for per se whatsoever. It's also an opportunity to illustrate and showcase your big picture understanding of how you can actually bring that idea, that invention, to a real commercial product that will be regulated, approved, endorsed, and condoned. And if I'm an investor, if I'm a VC, if I'm a founder of a company or advisor or anything like that, it's important to me and valuable to me to realize that the people involved, even if they're at the bench, even if they have an idea that's not an invention yet, even if they have an invention that's not a product yet, if they understand what it takes to de-risk that valley of death, to bring that to the real world and account for regulatory constraints, opportunities, barriers, and processes, it's really going to, you know, show maturity, show understanding, show context, and then de-risk that investment. So don't discount that whatsoever. On the contrary, see that as an opportunity to showcase your understanding of the big picture.
Great, thank you all. So I think I heard a number of things that developers can do, right? We can invite our regulatory friends in for consultations. We can invite them to competitions to keep it on top of developments. What are other things that the regulators themselves can do to start being able to keep up with what might be coming down the line, right? What types of horizon scanning tips and tricks can we sort of offer to maintain that engagement so that, you know, a lot of this conversation has focused on, you know, the role of the developer in reaching out, and how do we also, you know, invite them to reach out to us in other ways?
I'll try here. I think one of the things that's been difficult over the last, you know, 12 more or more years in interacting with some of the folks who have these portfolios is recognizing, you know, they just need more resources. Like, they have such an important role to play. And as we're talking about more products and more people, that one of the things we have to advocate for across the system is how to make sure that these types of positions are well equipped. And so, and also being able to advocate for the types of additional, you know, funding and communities and support for larger, you know, regulatory science programs that also help to fund innovations and risk management and the tools to support it. I think that, but that's going to require a lot of different types of groups that come together and say, you know, we have to develop the infrastructure to prepare for the future. developing pathways for, you know, safeguarding, but also develop, like, how can we learn? How can we learn from the regulations that after, you know, since 1984 in the coordinated biotechnology framework, we have some evidence base that we can say, okay, what next? And I realize there's so many constraints around this. But we really require everybody saying that we need to keep pace to make sure that we can actually, you know, take advantage of the benefits of these wide array of technologies.
One interesting, perhaps, lessons learned, and I can't provide any lessons, but I can point to where we might learn something is from the, you know, from the COVID-19 pandemic. Actually, it would be very interesting to hear from FDA regulators, even just say from the in vitro diagnostics portion of it, the amount of submissions that they got of creative new kinds of diagnostics and other things, and the way that they dealt with a deluge of applications. For example, we've interacted with them a fair amount and still kept everything running would be very interesting to hear. And I don't know any answers, but I'd love to hear the postmortem of that at some point and hear how they dealt with it and what was learned.
I love the point David just made. And I think we heard about a few numbers today in trends, right? So we'll understand, you know, vaccine regulation has been important the last 2 years, and they've had to turn that on, turn that up. I think Shella mentioned this morning that there's like over 1,000, right, grass cases and dossiers that have been reviewed over time. And I'm sure there's a trend. It's not been the same evenly over a certain period of time. So I think using data analytics to recognize trends and then use that to inform resource allocation and budget planning is very much part of the big picture. So if you look at the CRISPR literature, you don't have to read all 29,000 papers per se, but you have to recognize there's a trend in publications. There's a trend in technology development. There's a trend in the exploitation of that technology, not just in human gene therapies and therapeutics, not just in diagnostics, not just in plant breeding, but in GEMs. And we have to prepare accordingly because it's coming, and it's coming fast, and it's real, and it's now. And if you plan on budgeting for this in 2023, it's going to be too late. So I think having data informed and pattern recognition informed resource allocation is very important. And they have their own data. They know what people are submitting. They know how many queries they get. They know how many questions they get. So I think it's having a little bit more data-informed allocation of resources. And when things change and shift dramatically, use that as an argument to ask for better or more budgets.
And if budget was in hand, I think, you know, Megan mentioned fellowships. I think it's clear that, you know, the research is always going to run far ahead and faster. And so if you have ways of attracting, you know, maybe graduate students that are interested in a regulatory perspective, but, you know, worked at the bench, we're just basic scientists, I think ways of, you know, more opportunities for those people to spend 2 years, you know, working in a regulatory format. But again, you have to have the resources. I think that's the problem.
I'll just do a quick mention of everything that you guys said, Brett, agree with all of that. I'll also mention just the relationships that are built over time. For me, these relationships with regulatory folks are invaluable and have been handed down from program manager to program manager, especially in the context of similar technologies or programs. And that's been very helpful. And I think that, you know, the professionals that I work with in the regulatory agencies have all been terrific and overworked, I suppose, is probably the bottom line there. We talk about resources, so.
Great, thank you all. So I know that we are close to time or running up on time. So I just wanted to take a quick one around the table or the Zoom room. If we could just say something that we're all really excited about seeing in terms of the technology development. I think that question was posed earlier to an earlier set of panelists. And I thought it was a great way to sort of end with, you know, what are you looking forward to seeing as the technology develops?
I'm so excited about so many of these applications. Again, it's really hard to see. I think for me, it's seeing really just the blossoming, I think, of an entire area around many biotechnology applications and the bioeconomy writ large, but also seeing the way that we're really rethinking the infrastructure to support that at all levels. And I would consider this regulatory interface to be part of that. And I think reframing, as Rodolphe said at the beginning, not as a barrier, but as a set of enablers, right? Enablers that guide it in the right direction. And we're seeing, you know, the beginning of evaluations of not just risk management, but how do we understand the benefits for big areas in climate change and many other areas. I will say in particular, since I'm in biosecurity as well, I think seeing in the midst of the pandemic sort of biosecurity innovations like the ones that Anne has helped foster and others that really think about how we can develop solutions to existing sets of risks through biotechnology, including biological threats. So that's an area I'm watching closely.
Great, thank you. And so, David.
Yeah, one thing broadly, I think maybe doesn't get enough attention. We, as synthetic biologists, we we think about building things, right? We think about usually this synthesizing genes and the synthesis, right? We don't always think about the assay and the metrics unless we have to use that as part of, say, a directed evolution type approach. And I think, you know, to put it another way, you know, we can read and write DNA, but we oftentimes don't exactly know what to say. And I think the better metrics, better analytical tools, DNA sequencing is great as a tool and can be reformatted in many ways. But I think continued developments in analytical chemistry and mass spec and other spectroscopic methods that can be deployed more broadly in the environment is going to be super important as we start to move outside of the lab. And I think that's important for the science and also for the regulatory perspective.
Thank you. Rodolphe?
Yeah, I mean, if I give a technological scientific answer to this, I mean, to me, it's about delivery of genome editing modalities, right? So delivering with phages, delivering with RNA only and doing DNA-free genome editing, screening for natural mutations that occur in nature where the organism pre-exists, or things like using the endogenous systems in bacteria where you don't even need to bring CRISPR to do CRISPR-based genome editing. So there's a few frontiers out there that are very important that are going to be on the rise that we've worked on and other people have worked on that are very, very promising. We'll take that to the next level and enable us to do that in situ as opposed to do that in the lab and then deploy the bacteria. So I think that's going to be an area of very fast, very promising, very enabling change. But of course, in addition to this, this is why we're here today, right? Having meetings like this is part of the solution. And I hope this is the first of many. And I hope a lot of the hundreds of people here today will realize this and become part of that thought process of how are we going to do this? How can we do this at scale and at speed? And again, how can we do this together? It's not, again, like a barrier, it's an enabler. It's not a challenge, a hurdle, right? It's a facilitator and a driver. And I want to change that mindset. And to me, that's part of the solution, not part of the problem.
Thank you. And Anne?
Yeah, so a couple of things. So kind of jumping off the theme of safety by design from Safe Genes, is actually being able to monitor and detect synthetic genes in the environment or that are being perpetuated as an enabler of a technology. So being able to do that with ease and with fidelity and precision is important to actually allow things to move forward. And then the other area, I'll just mention the context of the DoD is operationalizing biotechnology. And so there's modernization strategies for biotechnology coming out of the DoD. To use, especially in the areas of biomanufacturing, sort of industrialized biomanufacturing for production of products. So that's another area that I think is going to increase in scope.
Great. Well, I want to take a moment to thank all of you for your sharing your thoughts today and sharing your time with all of us today. And with that, I'll turn it over to Melinda.